Now, when you use the terms power and potential, that itself is a very loaded thing. See, who has the power, who wields that kind of power is also pretty much linked to which social group you belong to. Now, I'll give you an example of Maharashtra as recent as a few years back, where a Dalit family in Vidarbha, Bhotmange family, which was trying to, which actually moved up the ladder, okay? They managed to buy land, they managed to cultivate that land, they were educating their daughters. So in a classical sense, you know, you move up the class and you should be able to, conquer all the barriers. But that family, you probably heard of that Khairlanji massacre case, that they were wiped out, simply. I mean, this is very definitively a caste struggle, where you see mobility and there is, you know, the social norms are so strong, the caste difference, I mean the caste norms basically are so strong that this kind of a mobility is not even entertained. So I mean, how mobility is simply not a matter of class. Mobility is a matter of how your caste, your status as woman, man intersects with each other. So ideally is what you say, you know, if I have money, I should be able to buy better quality land in, say, a downstream area in a watershed or be at the head reaches of a canal command. But that simply is not, there are so many constraining factors that are at work that it does not permit that kind of a mobility. And this is a broad picture. It doesn't mean that, you know, people don't have that agency. So that whole question of, does it mean that everything is so pessimistic and that structural issues of caste, class, I mean, they're simply unsurmountable. That's not what I'm trying to say. That, of course, people still exercise choice and agency. But nonetheless, there are a huge amount of constraining factors in which this whole power dynamics, because you belong to a certain group, certain caste, a woman, so even though you may have representation as a committee member in a water users association, you are simply made to say that, yeah, everyone is saying, so why do I need to speak out? You know, that's the kind of response women give. So that is the reason why we need to understand this disadvantage in connection with the location and with also the resources that are available at their disposal. Yeah, so is that sort of issue, I mean, in terms of locations and even intersectoral, you know, who has access to quality of domestic water, whether it is, or whether you are simply engaged in the industrial sector or you are not. All of these have very strong linkages with where you come from in terms of your economic location as well as your social location and the connection. Now, we had an overview of policies in the morning. Joy did that. Now, he did a pre and post 90s kind of a scenario. Now I'm sort of trying to discuss how each of these instruments or tools are actually being used to the advantage or to the disadvantage of the social groups that we are talking about. So it's an open question. We can debate it. It's not such a straightforward sort of an argument that, you know, everything that is part of the post 90s has only marginalized the poor and marginalized certain groups, and everything pre 90s when the state was in charge was very much welfare and there was more sort of positive support for the socially disadvantaged groups. I don't know, how do you look at it? Because we looked at sort of the three broad pillars that Joy spoke of in the morning, where the post-90s, pre-90s, the state had a much more proactive role, whereas in the post-90s, you see state as more, more as a facilitator, managing demand rather than actually giving the supply, you know, that we are not providers, but we are more facilitators. So the post-90s scenario definitely started looking at water more as a commodity, more as a economic good, rather than what the welfare state probably looked at, the way the state looked at water in the pre-90s. So how would you assess in terms of the pre-90s and the post-90s kind of a scenario with these three broad principles where institutional and economic reforms actually came in, right? I mean, institutional reforms in terms of you have participatory decentralization, water users committees coming in a significant way, but pricing and cost recovery also very critical components of that post-90s kind of a reform process. And all these three were seen as very self-optimizing in the sense that if these three are introduced, the sector is going to be restructured. Okay, I mean, there were no doubts about that, that this is the sort of panacea and this is the answer to all the problems. But the pre-90s scenario wasn't too great either. I mean, we have so much of, you know, social groups never really had a say. In fact, decentralization, has it probably through its representation brought in some space and some visibility to these groups, are a lot of questions. So how would you sort of try to analyze it? Just think for maybe 5 minutes, and because it was already discussed in the morning, so I don't want to go through. Do you think pre-90s was better or post-90s is better in terms of the water reform for the poor, for the socially disadvantaged groups?
Probably it would be that most people have been put out of poverty post-90s than they were before. And obviously, post-pre-90s was very much ossified, was very much cast down the day, the maintenance, the reach, where from the traditional ruling class. In a strange way, the market and urbanization seems to break down those ossifications to some extent. And thus, certainly doesn't seem to be tucked down in the modern cities, as Ambedkar has said, and as the market would start doing. Now, as they do improve, so I think ultimately it looks like the post-90s model also will be resurrected. And those three items we put forward were not shown as familiar, they were seen as something to step forward because we were not sustaining the old one. So could we try something new? And it was not ossified or said this was the way it was. So I think the progress has been much more significant.
The debate
has been much more post-90s.
Okay. Any other points of counter-argument? Because a lot of, I mean, when you critique the post-90s, you also are saying that, you know, the pre-90s was better or not. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure each of you is thinking.
Pre-90s also, but now people are realizing about their rights, and the conceptual, there is conceptual clarity of gender. Earlier, I think it was not there. People were not that aware, and there were many angles to it also. People were not educated, and the social setup that the pre-90s was slightly different. And in post-global era, various things changed, and that too drastically it has changed. The life of women has changed. So I think both scenarios are totally different. You cannot say that before pre-90s there was less thing. I think it is a realization which we are now realizing things that yeah, it existed.
Mm-hmm. So you are trying to say that the contexts were also different, so you cannot attribute only thing to everything to reform.
It was existing. Thing was existing earlier also, but now it has aggravated to some extent. And now people have started realizing, and they are now talking about the rights. Because now women have realized that they are affected by it.
Okay.
Post-90s difficult to look at it. Yes, it has happened. Markets have, in some sense, because it is agnostic and because it works for certain different principles. But the baseline at the 90s, those who were more privileged, whether it is class, caste, or in any kind of privileged position, they are the ones who could consolidate their gains and partake in the market process. So, and for example, tribal. So I don't think I was trying to recall how they were pre-90s and post-90s. I really don't see any difference. There would have been difference had they been educated, had they been better access to knowledge, information, possibly assets. Oh. So who could have written the post-90s way? But that was not to be. So essentially, the fault lines remain as they are. where possibly the ones who are better equipped or better privileged would take that. That opportunity was additional, I would say, which was not in one of the instances earlier.
But there was an opportunity that was created.
Possibly there was. I would say that there was an opportunity, but that opportunity was open for very few. It was not a physical barrier, but it was the endowment or the capability of the section of people who could make use of those opportunities, and it was not open for everyone. It still is not.
Okay. I want to engage with this issue about whether I'm making a relative assessment of pre and the post 90s slightly differently. I don't want to pitch this whole discussion between, I mean, otherwise it is like that, it's polarized between, for example, the pre-90s was the statist model to some extent, and you have the post-90s as the market type of thing. I think there is a lot of areas in between which has happened. I do agree that compared to 90s, if it politically decentralization post which has taken place, not only because the, you know, whatever the amendments came and other type of thing, but there have been movements of the people who are either the Dalits or the obvious to capture political space. And what happened in Bihar and UP, we might look at it from a urban perspective, saying that Lallu Prasad Yadav and other type of people. But there was a definite process of decentralization of political power, and people who, or sections, who are not in the political power so far really captured power. I think that is a complete drift, after emergency or that type of a thing which has taken place, which has, I think, so that has nothing to do with market. I wouldn't say that it's market or urbanization which has this one. Yeah. It is actually a political struggle by the people to capture a space for themselves. I think that's it. And some of the legislation which came out of that is also to address some of this unrest, whether it is Naxal movements earlier period and very then land reforms and other type of things to some extent came through backdoor entries. And I think it's also, I think we cannot, dispense, or we cannot say that, then other things which is actually movements the people have not contributed to type of thing. Second thing which I would say is that one, what I would say, which is that contribution to some extent is that this whole thing that statist models of development does not seem to be delivered, and people seem to be disillusioned with that. That disillusionment also comes to not urbanization market type of thing, it's also because I think some of those models have failed, whether it is the water sector or other type of things don't. So that's why this whole emphasis about, community-based management system. So I would say that between these two, this whole space for collective action, which actually set the stage after the 90s or 85 onwards, I think is an important factor to take into account when we assess this pre-90s and post-90s context. I would agree that urbanization has a strength to overcome some of the, let's say, caste restrictions to some extent. But if you see, what is the basic character of a caste today? Basic character of caste is that one is hierarchy. Ambedkar has this famous saying that this is a division of labor. People say that caste is a division of labor, it's a division of laborers. Basically, that if you are born in a particular caste, then you are forced to get a certain type of thing. And you look at today, even in the height of capitalism and globalization of capital type of thing, still you would see who is in the fourth, the type of municipal, kamgars or sanitary workers, and other type of, it is 95%. Is the this one. You look at all the IS and type of thing. So some of these realms we have not been able to democratize, even with all type of urbanization and other type of thing which is taking. So caste gets reproduced in a different way. Yes, the other character is basically what you call roti beti vyavahar, that is basically eating together, untouchability, and actually intercaste marriages. I think, okay, in terms of roti, that is eating together, as things have broken together, but still you can see remnants of that, even in the water sector, where caste has become a point of excluding people from services, where the spring is, we had a nice workshop in Dehradun in which people came up stories after stories. The same spring is shared by two communities, upstream communities, say upper caste, and the downstream communities, the lower caste. Still people have problems accessing water in the lower type of thing. Or near Mahad, the famous Satyagraha Ambedkar, to open up the Mahad,
Chowdhary,
to this one, close to that, Manga. 10 years back, the entire system of wells which the Dalits were, still there are different water sources for Dalits, and the upper caste put human excreta into that, became a very serious water conflict. This also up in our book on this. So why is it that caste as a thing has not actually, it has changed shapes, it has changed forms, but in terms of intercaste marriages, still it is. Why these honor killings are coming up in a big manner? I think these are symptoms to say that market has not really, otherwise people believe that, you know, once you have capitalism, then all the other feudal remnants, you know, diminish. I think in India we have a very comfortable coexistence of class and caste taking place, though the its forms, very raw forms have changed and things, but I do not believe that, you know, things have changed too much. Yes, urbanization does help to, you know, break some of these obvious forms and things.
Yeah.
But there are other factors which taken up, so, you know, we need to take into account.
Yeah. Interestingly, India has... Yeah, you wanted to.
I just want to add that it all depends on your geography, whether you are living in an urban area or rural area, because all the development, which we call development of post-90s, happened, opportunities occurred in urban areas and the resources were being spread in the rural areas. So, if you are a disadvantaged group in rural area, so they suffer the most when the resources are being taken away by corporates or more development which is coming up. But if you are migrated from rural area to urban, the opportunities are there and anybody can work. And expensive also, I think, so women can work. I mean, they have got more opportunities to work. So it all depends on where you are.
Yeah, but even in the urban context, you see so many disparities, right? I mean, if I were to look at my own city, it's when I look at the statistics, I'm shocked that 40% of my city's population lives in slums, which was not the case, say, 10 years ago. I mean, there are many factors responsible for that. But urban poverty is actually, the nature of it is changing, and I think also the extent.